excuse me. Yeah.
At the very end.
Okay, we're ready?
Okay. Good evening, everyone. I invite you to please stand and face the entrance of the church. Dear brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you. Welcome to this liturgy, which marks the beginning of this year's celebration of the Sacred Triduum. On this Holy Thursday night, it is now time to enter into the Paschal Triduum, the three great days celebrating the Lord's Passion, Death, and Resurrection. Our Triduum celebration over these 3 days will be like a symphony, which, though it has different movements, is a complete feast of the same mystery. Our celebration tonight flows into and is part of Good Friday and Easter. Indeed, it is a special night of entrance. We should glory in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, for he is our salvation, our life, and our resurrection. Through him we are saved and made free.
Our gathering hymn is number 838, Come to the Feast. We will do verses 1 and 2 at the beginning. Number 838.
My brothers and sisters, we have completed our Lenten observance and now have begun the solemn celebration of the Easter feast. On these great days, it is our duty to glory in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, in whom we have salvation, life, and resurrection. The oils that we receive tonight were blessed and consecrated at the Chrism Mass by Archbishop Peter Hunt on Tuesday of this week for our use in our parish throughout this year. With these oils, the sick will be anointed. Those awaiting the waters of rebirth will be strengthened. and those who are baptized and confirmed will share the mission of Christ, the Anointed One. By the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, who fills these holy oils with life and grace, the saving work of Christ Jesus is continued in the Church.
Behold the oil of the sick. Receive God's grace and healing.
By the laying on of hands and anointing with this oil, and with the prayerful support of this community, may those who are sick gain strength even in their suffering. May they be released from fear and experience the healing presence of Christ.
Behold the oil of catechumens. Receive God's strength and wisdom.
Anointed with this oil and assisted by this community's example, may our catechumens persevere in their journey to the saving waters of baptism and share in Christ's victory over sin and the power of evil.
Behold the sacred chrism. Give thanks, O priestly people.
Through anointing with this fragrant oil, may all who are baptized and confirmed, all who are ordained to the service of God's people, and this assembly whose altar and church are dedicated to God's glory, fill the world with the sweet fragrance of Christ's gospel, and be built up as living stones into a temple filled with the Holy Spirit.
We will continue our gathering hymn number 838 with verse 3.
Yeah.
Let us sing the praises of the Lord, the God who made us, whose glory is from age to age. Let us pray. To learn the mystery of sacrificial love, O God, we come to the supper hosted by your Son, to the table where the sinless one delights to eat and drink with sinners. Touch our hearts with wonder to see the Lord enwrapped in glory, tie a towel around his waist. The Master, whom raging seas obey, pour water into a servant's basin. The one whom angels wait on, kneel down to wash the disciples' feet. As we enter this three-day Pasch, cleanse us within, that we may keep the festival, not with the old yeast of malice and evil, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity, humility, and truth. We ask this through your Son, the Christ, our Passover and peace, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us be attentive to God's word.
A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided into proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year-old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs.
this is how you shall eat it, with your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm is number 1040.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, I've received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who is bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. You are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was about to betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet and put on his robe and returned to the table, Jesus said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you." The Gospel of the Lord. On this Holy Thursday night, I find myself thinking about something quite different, something I have never thought about before on Holy Thursday. And I doubt you know what it is. I find myself wondering, what kind of basin did Jesus use to wash the disciples' feet? Was it made of wood? Perhaps it was forged from some kind of metal, like copper. Perhaps it was clay and glazed on the inside. Maybe it was ceramic. I'll never know the answer to my query. However, I do know what the basin contained. Yes, it contained water, but so much more. In fact, what that basin contained was disruptive, shocking, even scandalous, and at the same time, more than the disciples could have ever hoped for. Let me explain what I mean. As the Gospels tell us, the upper room where the Last Supper was held was a private one. And because of that, the disciples were responsible for setting it up and preparing the Passover meal. Therefore, the usual custom of the homeowner being present to welcome his guests and to conduct the ritual foot washing as they arrived, as was customary, was not going to happen. Typically, back in that day, the homeowner's slave would have been the one to wash the feet of the guests, to clean them from the dust and the dirt that accumulated from traveling the road. The washing of the feet was a job considered fit only for a slave, someone with no status, having no dignity or honor in the eyes of society of the time. Certainly a crime, certainly something that we in our day would rightly protest against. But sadly, in Jesus' day, this was the norm. When Jesus takes off his outer garment and wraps a towel around his waist, he's not just washing the disciples' feet. He's not just caring for those tired, dirty, dusty feet. He takes on the role of the slave. When he takes off his outer robe and wears that garment, basically he is in his underwear, and he is dressed like a slave would be. Furthermore, Jesus kneels before each disciple. The scandal continues. One only knelt before someone of higher social status. Jesus was teacher and Lord, and so in that room, he was the one amongst the disciples who enjoyed the higher status. But he reverses that and kneels before the disciples. Jesus' washing of the feet was more, as I said, than a customary ritual. It was profound, it was radical, and it was pure gift. It was a moment of teaching, and it was a moment of encounter with God's loving grace, caring for the disciples. It is, one could argue, almost sacramental. Imagine all of that in a simple basin of water. Jesus uses the washing basin to teach the disciples that true service does not stand on status, nor does it stand on social, cultural, or religious customs.
True service kneels in humility. It happens through the shedding of hierarchy, as well as the trappings that often surround positions of leadership. It happens not in standing in a position of dominance, but it happens on one's knees, in a position of submission. It is entirely focused on the well-being of the other. It is gift, pure and simple. And it comes as a surprise to the disciples, as many gifts often do. And it comes on that night in a simple basin of water. That particular basin, long gone now, heralds the arrival of God's grace in the lives of the disciples. And for us who are about to commemorate that, the basin heralds the arrival of God's grace in our lives. Carried metaphorically in more modern kinds of basins that still wash the feet of weary people today. Our feet carry us through life, don't they? We stand upon this earth, God's creation, on our feet. We begin and end each day on our feet. They bear the burden of not only the weight of our bodies, but the weight of life's responsibilities, its joys, its accomplishments, its sorrows and defeats that we go to and fro amongst. When Jesus washes the disciples' feet in that basin, he is immersing not just their feet, but their very selves, body and soul, into the tenderness, the care, the respect, the dignity, and the healing that can only come from God. Like that night so long ago, we too experience the washing of the feet anytime something happens in our life where we feel tender care, when we feel respected, when we are treated with dignity, and when we feel healed by receiving humble service. In those moments of your life and mine that are like that, God washes us in grace. And like the disciples, it has and it will happen at moments that are unexpected. And we'll be surprised to see in such moments that it is actually God carrying the basin to wash our feet. Now, you might say to me, that's well and good, but in our world today, such moments of being bathed and washed in love and tenderness, respect and dignity seem few and far between. For we live in a world that seems all too focused on power and the infliction of suffering in all kinds of ways by the powerful upon the innocent. However, it still happens. We are still washed in God's grace. And I'm going to give you an example of that now by telling you the story of a basin. Well, actually, it's a basket. And it's this basket. I'm going to ask Stephen to hold it up. Several weeks ago, Ciro, David, and I, as the Redemptorist community here, were given this basket as a gift in gratitude of our support of a program that happens every Christmas at His Majesty's Penitentiary in St. John's. The program is run by a chaplain, many of you whom you know, Jerry Phelan. The program consists of inmates reading Christmas stories to their children. The book itself records the father's voice. And then the chaplain sends the book on to the family. This way, a son or a daughter gets to hear Daddy read them a Christmas story on Christmas Eve, even though Daddy is incarcerated. This basket, you can put it down now, Stephen, thank you. This basket was made by an inmate at HMP. He made it out of 450 wooden forks, the kind that the inmates use to eat their meals. It is lined with a piece of cloth cut from a bedsheet, the kind of bedsheets that cover the bunks of the inmates at HMP. To make this basket, the inmate glued it together by making a paste that he made mixing toothpaste and powdered milk. Imagine for a moment the hours it took this man, who I do not know, the hours it took him sitting in his cell to make this basket. To make this basket as a gesture of gratitude and thanks to people he didn't know who made it possible that his son could hear his voice on Christmas Eve reading a Christmas story. Now, I tell you this story not because it's about us Redemptorists, but I tell you this story because we as a community, when we received this basket last week, we were washed in this inmate's gratitude, kindness, love, and tender care. I have no doubt that this inmate in HMP, through him, Jesus came and washed us in his grace. I also have no doubt, more than any liturgical action on any Holy Thursday, this basket for me is the essence of the ritual that we call foot washing. It is the basin in which Jesus' grace came to us last week, not from a decorated altar, but from a prison cell in HMP on the shores of Kittyvitty. God's grace continues to wash us in this world. Perhaps that is why, as he has done since the start of his pontificate, Pope Francis will again tonight wash the feet of the incarcerated in a prison just outside of Rome as he celebrates Holy Thursday. He too knows where to find Christ and where to encounter grace. May all of us be open to receiving such a washing in God's grace, wherever, however, and from whomever it may come. Please remain seated. Let us now do what Christ asked us to do, to wash the feet of one another. In this celebration of the liturgy, I'd like to invite those who are coming forward to have their feet washed on your behalf to come forward now. Let us prayerfully open our minds and hearts to be open to receive God's tender, loving, healing grace that bathes us all.
Told them this is
Having washed one another's feet, I invite you to please stand and let us join our prayers now, calling upon God's grace to wash us all. You'll have the intercession. Through the Paschal Triduum, we carry in our hearts the whole of creation and all of God's people, especially where there is brokenness, suffering, fear, and illness. And so we pray.
That the love of Christ that has gathered us together will unite all people in striving to build up God's kingdom through prayer and good works. And that the food of this Eucharist meal will strengthen and sustain us. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Pope Francis, Archbishop Peter, all our clergy, and the people of this archdiocese, that the Holy Spirit will continue to guide our church, both locally and universal. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are suffering, that God will help the hungry find food, the persecuted relief, the abandoned inclusion and acceptance, and the unemployed new opportunities to use their gifts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the grace of unity, that divisions may be healed, unity restored, and that we may support one another in bringing forth the reign of God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and homebound of our community, that their communion with us in Christ may be a source of healing and strength. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who suffer the agony of death, for our own loved ones, and for the victims of war and civil discord in all the world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, you wash the feet of your disciples. Help us to recognize when and where humble, loving service is called for, and to strengthen us to offer that service to one another. For you are Lord forever and ever.
Our hymn is number 502, Stay Here and Keep Watch With Me. Number 502.
Stay here and keep watch.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries, for whenever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he is the true and eternal priest who instituted the pattern of an everlasting sacrifice and was the first to offer himself as the saving victim, commanding us to make this offering as his memorial. As we eat his flesh that was sacrificed for us, we are made strong. As we drink his blood that was poured out for us, we are washed clean. And so with angels and archangels and the thrones and dominions and all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we now acclaim. To you, therefore, most loving Creator, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Peter, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offered for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in the hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. Celebrating this, the most sacred day on which our Lord Jesus Christ was handed over for our sake, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of God and our Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Andrew, and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this offering of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you, as we observe the day on which our Lord Jesus Christ handed on the mysteries of his body and blood for his disciples to celebrate. Order our days in your peace, and command that we may be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. on the day before he was to suffer for our salvation and the salvation of all, that is, today. He took bread in his holy hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice in his holy hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the cup of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by your hands, by the hands of your holy angel, to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who, through this participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and every heavenly blessing.
Remember also, Lord, your servants who have died, have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace.
To us also, your servants, good to sinners, hope eager our mercy, grace in hand, song share, and a fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthew, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints, as we ask to receive you into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Together let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come.
thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer one another a sign of God's peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Communion hymn is number 943, Bread of Life from Heaven, number 943.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, that just as we are renewed by the supper of your Son in this present age, so we may enjoy his banquet for all eternity, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Our Mass will conclude this evening with a procession of the Blessed Sacrament to the altar of repose. The church will be left open until midnight. Midnight for a quiet prayer and devotion. If you wish to stay, there will be somebody here until then. At midnight, the church will be locked. We'd invite you to stay as long as you want or to come back and to participate in this holy night. And we'd ask that once the procession is over and we disperse, that you observe a time of quiet as you leave, indicative of the sacredness of this holy night.
Love divine and new, all giving gives himself up.